Hello, I'm Ben Godwin. Welcome to the Word Workshop, recorded at the Good Springs Full Gospel Church.
God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy.
My wife Michelle and I have pastored the Good Springs Full Gospel Church since 1999, a spirit-filled church with a hunger for God and a heart for people. Good Springs Full Gospel Church is located in Walker County on Highway 269, 10 miles south of Jasper.
The prophet said that the knowledge of the glory of the Lord will cover the earth as the waters cover the sea.
So prepare your hearts to receive from the Word, because when all else fails, God's Word works.
Bibles, if you will, please, to the book of James. The book of James. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Let me show you a couple of pictures before we get into the Word. This was our cabin up in Gatlinburg. It's a beautiful cabin. Sleep about 30 folks. And this is a cluster of cabins up there. They're all new. This is where the fire came through, I believe, in 2016. That devastated Gatlinburg. So these are all new units. Very, very nice. Very scenic. Look at that view. That's a killer view, isn't it? I don't know whose picture. Is that my is or your picture? I pirated somebody's picture off of Facebook so I could show you. Man, you feel, for some reason, you just feel closer to God when you're up in the mountains. I don't know if it's the altitude or what, but we had a great time. Here was our group. There were 19 of us. We got to go to the Pirates Voyage dinner show. That was fun. Had a motley crew, yeah. And we got to have some fun and have some good fellowship. It was very enjoyable. And then, well, we drove back to Chattanooga on Monday. And then Tuesday night, I was at youth camp, Camp Tribe, up on Signal Mountain outside of Chattanooga. That's Brother Pastor Keith Nix and his associate, Brother Caleb Pierce. And we had a good time preaching at youth camp. There's about 180 campers up there, plus faculty and staff. And we just had a great, great time in the Lord. So thank you for your prayers while we were gone. Wanted to share this. I'm a grown-up. I groan when I get up. Anybody relate to that? How about this? When you get to heaven and see Adam and Eve, you going to give them the look? No, all will be forgiven. Praise God. And I saw this shirt I had to share with you. After God made me, he said, ta-da. You've heard after God made somebody, he broke the mold, right? Well, look at somebody and say, ta-da. Praise God. We're one of a kind. Amen. We're all unique. Well, one thing we got to do while we were up there, I've been wanting to do for years. I am kind of a history buff. I wanted to go to the Titanic Museum, and we finally got to go. And I love history. I'm fascinated by it. And there you see Michelle and I were reenacting, you know, Jack and Rose on the movie there. Praise the Lord. She won't let me drown, though. Thank God. Hallelujah. Here's what I want to use for a subject today. Gigantic lessons from the Titanic. Gigantic lessons from the Titanic. It's been 109 years since the sinking of the Titanic, and it's still very intriguing. They're still learning what exactly happened, how to avoid it. We learn from history that we don't learn enough from history, because we seem to keep repeating it, don't we? Those who forget the past are condemned to repeat it. I had you go to James chapter 4. I want to read several verses there. Verse 13, when you get there, shout amen. Well, that wasn't a shout, but it was an amen. Anybody not there, say wait. No slowpokes. All right. James 4:13. Come now, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go to such a city and spend a year there and buy and sell and make a profit, whereas you do not know what will happen tomorrow. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we shall live and do this or that. But now you boast in your arrogance. All such boasting is evil. Finish it with me, verse 17. Therefore, to him who knows to do good and does it not, to him it is sin. Lord, help me to say something practical, something relevant, something meaningful, something of long-term value. Take the words that you've given me and just permeate our hearts, penetrate our hearts with truth that'll set us free. When we leave this place, it's my prayer that we'll all be closer to God and know we've been in the presence of God. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen and amen. You don't know what tomorrow holds. That's why today is the day of salvation. Do not delay. Old timers had a saying, Lord willing and the creek don't rise. How many have heard that saying before? Lord willing and the creek don't rise. Sure, we make plans, we set goals, we schedule events, but we must submit our agenda to God's will. Too many times we set our agenda and we ask God to bless what we're doing. We need to pray in advance and do what God's blessing. Your kingdom come, your will be done. That ought to be our prayer as we go through our routine, our weekly schedule, our monthly schedule. Say it with me, your kingdom come, your will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Let's review the facts of the Titanic. The Titanic, at the time that it launched, was the largest ship the world had ever seen. It's the subject of many books, many movies, documentaries, ocean explorations. Set out on its maiden voyage, April 10th, 1912, from Southampton, England to New York City. In fact, the 1997 movie Titanic was the highest grossing movie in the history of movie making. It is third to Avengers and Avatar, but it raked in $2.2 billion. Shows you how fascinated people are with this tragedy that happened so long ago. Let me tell you a few facts about the Titanic. It was built with double bottoms. The hull was divided into 16 watertight compartments. The dimensions were 882 feet and 8 inches long. 92 and a half feet wide. It weighed 46,328 tons. Isn't it just a modern marvel that something like that could even float? That blows my mind. Think about that. It was 175 feet tall. It had a crew of 885 people. Passengers total 1,343. A grand total of 2,228 total passengers. It could hold maximum 3,500. The hull was constructed of 1-inch thick plate steel held together by over 3 million rivets. Somebody did some work. Isn't it interesting that God, Daniel said in the last days, knowledge would increase, that God has given man the wisdom and the know-how to even put together something like that. Of course, modern ships now dwarf the size of the Titanic. It cost $7.5 million to build then. If you adjust that for inflation, you're looking at close to $400 million today. That's a boatload, no pun intended. Top speed was 23 knots, which is roughly 26 miles an hour. It burned 600 to 800 tons of coal per day to power the steam engines. The fourth smokestack, it had four smokestacks, only three of them worked. One was a dummy, just because it looked better and was more symmetrical. You can learn a lot from a dummy, can't you? It took a team of 176 men to do nothing but shovel coal. I'm glad that wasn't my job. They actually, in the museum, they had a shovel with coal stuck to it where you could pick it up and act like you're putting it in the boiler. Hallelujah. I could handle that. Was this an omen? Think about this. It was a bitter cold night on deck, but after dinner, some second-class passengers gathered for hymn singing. At 10 p.m., the Mariner's hymn had these lyrics in them. Oh, hear us when we cry to thee for those in peril upon the sea. Coincidence? Who knows? At 11:40, a lookout spotted an iceberg that ripped a 300-foot gash in the ship's hull, and icy seawater flooded five of the ship's watertight compartments. The water was 28 degrees. At the museum, they have a special room, a special exhibit, where it looks like you're at the side of the ship, and you reach over as if you're putting your hand into the seawater, and it is chilled to 28 degrees. You put your hand in there, and within a few seconds, you can't feel your hand anymore. Hypothermia would set in very rapidly. The wreckage was found in 1985, 73 years after the disaster, by a French-American joint expedition. It's 12,500 feet down, 2.4 miles on the seafloor. Show you a picture of the Grand Staircase. This is a replica that is at the museum. It's the crowning glory of the Titanic. It's made of oak and mahogany, wrought iron, gold-plated in some areas. And get this, they had a special flooring. You can't see it in that picture, but we were there. They had a special type of flooring that was new on the market at that time that only rich people could afford. Linoleum. Now nobody wants linoleum in their house. They want tile or hardwood. But while we were there on tour, we went through the Grand Staircase. We went on, you know, several other rooms and exhibits. And we come back, you circle back at the end of the tour. And while we were there, a man proposed to a woman at the top of that staircase. And we all got to witness. And of course, we applauded and we were happy for him. But Michelle mumbled to me, I don't know if I'd want anything to do with the Titanic at my wedding. It doesn't end well. But it was a beautiful gesture. Let me give you four things. You may want to jot these down. I know this is different than the normal sermon, but this is what's burning my heart. Number one, the danger of presumption and pride. Proverbs 16:18, pride goes before destruction, a haughty spirit before a fall. James 4:6, God resists the proud but gives grace to the humble. How many need grace? I need grace. Did you know the number one thing on God's list of things he hates is a proud look? These six things does the Lord hate, seven are an abomination unto him. Proverbs 6:17, a proud look. What does presumption mean? We got to be careful. There's one thing to believe God and have faith. It's another thing to veer over into presumption. Presumption means to assume, to take for granted, to undertake with unreasonable boldness, to do without the right or permission, to go too far in acting or taking liberties. Acting with cautious wisdom does not indicate a lack of trust in God. For instance, we trust God, but we wear seat belts. We trust God, but we wear life jackets, right? We trust God, but we wash our hands. We trust God, but we use oven mitts with hot dishes. We trust God, but we lock our houses at night. So think about it. We trust God, but we use smoke detectors in our home. We trust God, but how many take medicine once in a while? Yeah. We trust God, but we don't grab a live wire. We don't jump off of tall buildings. We don't play in the street. We don't run up big debts and hope for a divine bailout. Hopefully not. Or do other foolish and dangerous things, expecting divine intervention. The Titanic had been warned about icebergs, and they disregarded that in order to set a transatlantic record. Think about this. Full speed ahead. They wanted to make history. They wanted to grab headlines. They did all right, but for all the wrong reasons. Think about this. Many passengers and crew believed the Titanic to be unsinkable. And even the ship's designers had suggested that. One passenger asked a ship's agent for extra insurance for some valuables in her luggage. The agent replied, "That's ridiculous. This boat is unsinkable." Captain Edward Smith himself was asked about the safety of the Titanic. Here's what he answered. "I cannot imagine any condition which would cause a ship to founder. I cannot conceive of any vital disaster happening to this vessel. Modern shipbuilding has gone beyond that." Boy, he missed that, didn't he? By the way, he was a British naval officer, and after 40 years of service and 27 years in command of different ships, he planned to retire after that trip. After the ship struck the iceberg, a passenger asked her employer if they should do something about it. He replied, "Go back to bed. This ship is unsinkable." When reports about the tragedy began to reach America, Philip Franklin, the vice president of the White Star Line in New York, responded, "We place absolute confidence in the Titanic. We believe the boat is unsinkable." One passenger asked a dockhand, "Is this ship really unsinkable?" The man replied, "Yes, lady, God himself could not sink this ship." He didn't have to. They did it all by themselves. The danger of presumption and pride. Let me tell you, my friend, our trust better not be in the government. Our trust better not be in man. Our trust better not be in banks and the economy and what man can do. Our trust better be in the Lord. Jeremiah said, "Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord. Cursed is the man who trusts in man and makes flesh his arm." Hallelujah. Yes, we thank God for modern technology. We thank God for everything God's given man wisdom to do. But my trust is not in a doctor. My trust is not in a lawyer. My trust is not in a banker. My trust, hallelujah, is not in the institutions of men. My trust is in the divine intervention of God. Hallelujah! It says it on the back of our dollars. In God we trust. Some trust in chariots, some in horses. We will remember the name of the Lord. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. Where is your trust? So we learn about the danger of presumption and pride, don't we? Here's the second lesson from the Titanic, the importance of preparation. There's an old saying, those who fail to prepare, what? Prepare to fail. There were 20 total lifeboats on board, two emergency boats that would hold 40 passengers, 14 wooden lifeboats that hold 65 each, and four collapsible canvas lifeboats. Total capacity of all these lifeboats was about 1,178 people. And remember, there were how many? 2,228 on board. So there wasn't enough lifeboats for quite half. Think about that. We're right at about half. The White Star Company didn't build more because they reached the legal limit and didn't feel it was necessary. Too expensive. Plus, after all, the ship was unsinkable, right? Some said lifeboats would make the decks look too cluttered and detract from the beauty and obstruct the view. There was no lifeboat drill or an evacuation plan that was conducted. The crew was poorly trained on how to use the davits. Those were the hoists that lowered the lifeboats down on the pulley systems. Think about this. Out of 2,228 passengers, only 705 survived. That means 1,523 died. Lifeboat 7, listen, had 24 people on board despite being able to hold 65. Lifeboat number 1 had 12 people and could have held 40. If all of the lifeboats were filled to capacity, 473 more people at least could have been saved. They weren't prepared. Which leads me to this question. Are you prepared? Are you prepared to meet God? Are you prepared for eternity? You know, we make a lot of preparations, don't we? We stock up money for kids to go to college, and we'll buy a grave plot, and we'll get a funeral plan, and we'll do all this. But what about eternity? We'll buy life insurance, but hallelujah, do you have assurance? Blessed assurance is a lot better than life insurance. Hallelujah. I'm glad I have blessed assurance. Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Hallelujah. Are you prepared? Here's the third lesson I learned from the Titanic. The folly of trusting in money. Rich and poor died alike together in a watery grave. There were 325 first class passengers, 285 second class passengers, 706 third class passengers. We learned this at the tour. These third class passengers, 706 of them, they had two bathtubs to share. One for the men, one for the women. They had sinks in their bunks. There were four beds and a little sink in the middle, and they'd take a little sponge bath or whatever, but they typically back then people only bathed once a week. On Saturday, whether they needed it or not. They were superstitious that the water might be contaminated or something. I don't know. Man, I thank God for a daily bath. Hallelujah. Somebody said revivals don't last. I say neither does a bath, but it sure helps. Hallelujah. Praise God. A first class ticket cost $4,350 in 1912. That would cost you about $83,000 this day. A second class ticket cost $60. That set you back about $1,200 now. Third class ticket, $40. That sets you back anywhere from $300 to $600, somewhere in there. There were famous millionaires on board, and all their money was worthless to buy them one more minute of time. America's first millionaire was aboard, John Jacob Astor. He was a businessman, a real estate developer, an investor, an inventor, a writer. He was worth an estimated $20 million then. That's worth about $110 billion today. He was on an extended honeymoon with his wife. It was quite the scandal. This was his second wife. She was 1 year younger than his son. She was 18 years of age. He was 47. She was pregnant, and they were coming back because they wanted to have the baby in the United States. Money didn't do him any good. There was another wealthy man you might have heard of, co-owner of Macy's department store, Isidore Strauss, and his wife Ida. They were returning back from a vacation in France. He refused to board a lifeboat before the women and children, even though he had affluence and status. She refused to leave him. They were last seen holding each other on the deck. Somebody urged him to get into the lifeboat. He said, I'm no better than these other men. I'm not taking someone else's spot, even though he had millions. How about that? Mining heir Benjamin Guggenheim was there. Engineer Thomas Andrews, who oversaw the ship's construction. The last dinner served to the first class passengers at the Ritz restaurant was a feast of oysters, caviar, lobster, quail, salmon, roast duck, lamb, beer, wine, and cigars. All of that wealth, all of that affluence, all of that, it means nothing when you stand before God. Are you with me this morning? Mark 8:36 says, what shall it profit a man if he gains the whole world and lose his soul. Do you know how valuable your soul is? Your soul is so valuable that God wants it and the devil wants it. I don't know about you, but I give it to God. I gave it to God as a six-year-old boy kneeling in my living room at my couch with my daddy during family devotions. Hallelujah. I said, God, I want you to have the most important thing in my life. I want you to have my soul. How many are glad you've given your soul to him? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. When it's our time to go, listen, no doctor, no medicine, no machine will keep us here. No amount of money can buy you any extra time. Listen, someone else could be living in your house next week. Somebody else could be driving your car next week. Somebody else could be wearing your clothes and spending your money next week. All that matters is, are you ready to meet God? Is your name in the Lamb's Book of Life? How many thank God you're washed in the blood, you're born again, you're a new creature, old things have passed away, all things have become new, hallelujah. Nothing between my soul and my Savior, the song says. Hallelujah. Here's the last big lesson I learned from the Titanic, the perils of ignoring warnings. At least seven wireless warnings, telegraphs about ice reached the ship. The wireless operator of the Messaba, another vessel, reported a large number of icebergs and an ice field in their path. The wireless operator on the Californian, 10 miles away, wired that they were stopped and surrounded by ice, the SS California. Titanic operator Jack Phillips wired, listen, keep out, shut up, I'm working Cape Race, which was another ship. He was messaging them. Plus, the telegraph system had broken the day before, and they had a backlog of private personal messages that the wealthy passengers wanted sent on. And he was busy doing all of that and couldn't be distracted by the fact that there was ice ahead. Finally, the Californian wireless operator, the closest ship that could have helped save many of them, closed down his set for the night at 11:30 and went to sleep. Many people wouldn't get into the lifeboats because they thought it was safer on the sinking ship than in a boat on the dark ocean. At least 8 flares were shot up into the night sky. The closest boat thought it was fireworks and that they were celebrating because they were on their maiden voyage and didn't get the SOS messages. They failed to heed the warnings. Here's what Proverbs 29:1 says, he who is often rebuked and hardens his neck will be suddenly cut off, and that without a remedy. Hell is real, my friend. Judgment day is real, my friend. Today is the day of salvation. You don't hear a lot of preaching about this, but it's necessary. I said it is necessary. Hebrews 9:27, as it is appointed unto men once to die, and after this, the judgment. Every one of us have an appointment with death. We can't cancel it. We can't postpone it. We can't reschedule it. We can't not show up. One day, we're going to die. What matters is that we're ready to meet God. When we do, don't ignore the warnings. God guarantees forgiveness for repentance, but he doesn't guarantee tomorrow for procrastination. Today is the day of salvation. Some people have the attitude, well, I'll get right with God when I'm ready. One problem with that. What if God's not dealing with you when you get ready? Holy Spirit says, I will not always strive with man. He draws, he woos, he convicts. And if you keep resisting and you keep rejecting and turning him away, finally says, okay, I'll let you have it your way. And if you die suddenly, who's to say you have time to repent? You could die in a heart attack in your sleep tonight. Say, Brother Ben, don't try to scare. I'm not trying to scare you. I'm trying to confront you with reality. Don't ignore the warnings. You're gambling with your soul. How do you know you'll have time to repent if you die suddenly? Let me say this. Destiny is not a matter of chance. Your eternal destiny is a matter of choice. People don't accidentally end up in heaven. People don't accidentally end up in hell. They choose to go where they go by accepting or rejecting Christ. How many are glad you've made the right choice? Accept Him. Today is the day of salvation. Some people are kind of like the man who fell out of a 20th story building, fell out of the window of a 20th story building, and he saw a man halfway down, and he said, "Doing fine so far." It's the sudden stop at the bottom. A lot of people are doing fine so far, but they haven't stood before God. And the Bible says we will all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Every one of us. There is nothing hid from Him with whom we had to do. The Bible says all things are open and naked before Him with whom we have to do. Last thing, and we'll wrap this up. You get anything out of this?
Yes.
Hope I'm making you think. Hallelujah. How about the band on the Titanic? This is interesting. The most impressive thing to me about the tour, we went in through all these rooms and exhibits, and when we came into what was called the music room, and there was a grand piano set up, and a gentleman dressed in the attire that they would have worn then, and they had behind him eight posters of the stringed instrument band. All their names and a little biographical information on them. And the man was just telling us a little bit about it. And he said that night, the eight-piece band had been playing in the first-class lounge. But after they struck the iceberg, they kept playing to calm the passengers. But as the ship began to sink and the waters began to rise, they went out on the front deck. And they continued to play to calm the passengers. But then the waters began to rise and they began to swirl around their ankles. And the leader of the band, he was a violinist. His name was Wallace Hartley. He stood up and he said to his fellows, he said, "Gentlemen, it's been a pleasure to serve with you." And he basically dismissed them. "You're free to go. You're relieved of your responsibility." They got their instruments and they walked off, turned to walk off, and he sat back down and began to play again. They took a few steps but turned right back around and came, and all eight of them stayed there. And this is the hymn they played, "Nearer, My God, to Thee." That is the last known song they played as the Titanic was sinking. I want you to think about that. What really mattered when they were confronted with death? What really mattered when it was life or death, heaven or hell? The only thing that mattered was being close to God and getting in a lifeboat. How many are glad you know the lifeboat? And His name is Jesus. I said His name is Jesus. Hallelujah. When you get on board, they give you a boarding pass. Looks like that. You're assigned one of the passengers or crew members, and it gives you a biography of them. I was crewman John Longmuir, pantry steward, age 19, resident of Southampton, England. And you keep this card with you until you get to the last place and you look where the survivors are and those that perished. And unfortunately, I didn't make it. Michelle had a passenger. What was yours? She didn't make it. Noah? He didn't make it. He's in the back. Donnie? You didn't make it. Can't swim. Not in 28 degree water. Emily? Emily made it. She was a seamstress. Survived, never got married, lived to be into her 90s, and worked where? Lord Taylor of New York. One out of the five of us survived. Here's the good news. 100 of 100 can survive if you know Jesus. I said, you're a survivor. Hallelujah. This body's going back to the dust. The question is not if you'll die. The question is, will you be ready to meet God when you die? All we're going to do is shed this shell. We're going to change addresses. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad you have hope? Aren't you glad there's life? Aren't you glad, hallelujah, that heaven is your home? Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Look at somebody and say, I'm a survivor. I'm a survivor. Why? I've been rescued. Hallelujah. I've been saved. I've been delivered. I've been born again. I'm a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I have hope that takes me beyond time into eternity. Amen. Stand with me if you will, please. I want you to bow your heads. If you're here today, you say, Brother Ben, I'm not 100% sure. I don't know if I died today, if I would make heaven my home. Hello everyone, this is Pastor Ben Godwin, thanking you for watching our broadcast today. I pray it has been a blessing and a source of spiritual enrichment for you and your family. I'd like to invite you to visit and subscribe to our YouTube channel, where you can view many more singing and preaching videos. Search for Good Springs Full Gospel Church at youtube.com. Also, please visit our website at goodspringsfgc.org. where you can learn more about our church and ministry, read many of my articles on a variety of subjects, find a direct link to our YouTube channel, shop our online store, and donate to our church and help support our TV ministry with debit, credit card, or PayPal. Also, you can mail in an offering the old-fashioned way to Good Springs Full Gospel Church, P.O. Box 3161, Jasper, Alabama, 35502. We can assist you in any way in your spiritual journey. Please contact us. And remember, when all else fails, God's word works.